The previous queries did not contain any join, and this is exactly now what we want to investigate, how to compute joins in MapReduce. So for this, we assume we have two tables, S and T. And in order to join, we have to make sure that the join partners that will be in the result are finding each other. So how can we guarantee this? Now, in the simplest case, we're looking at a natural join or an equi-join, which are testing for equality of an attribute A. So how can we now do this in MapReduce? The first idea is that you're sending all tuples from S and T that have the same value for this A attribute to the same reducer. Then this reducer is outputting the results. Why does this work? Well, we have our reducers. Let's say we have two. Or let's say we have three. And now we have our S and T tuples. And we're taking, let's say, an S tuple. Here's our S relation, and here's our attribute A. And there's some value 5 here, let's say. And there are also more tuples, of course, more attributes here, like B. And here's our T table. And there's also an attribute A that we do the join on. And let's say C and D. So in order to have this tuple with the A equals 5, meeting this tuple here with A equals 5, they both have to arrive at the same reducer. And this is really what the idea one says. So if you're emitting now the tuple from S according to S.A and the tuple itself, then this here, in this case, will be the 5. And 5, let's say, ends up at this reducer here. And since the 5 is routed to this reducer, of course, if we are emitting T according to the A attribute, and the tuple T itself, then also this tuple will end up at the same reducer. And this is what we have to have in order to guarantee the correctness of our join computation. Now there's a little trick we have to further consider, because when these tuples arrive here at the reducer, we should know where they came from, because we do not want to join S tuples with S tuples, only S tuples with T tuples, and not T tuples with T tuples. The second idea would take one of these relations, the smaller one, let's say this is T, and makes it available within all of the compute nodes, so that in the map phase, when the map task is reading tuples from S, it can be immediately checked with the entire relation T. Now this of course only works if T is really small, otherwise copying T around to all of the processing nodes would be too expensive. Okay, let's get back to the first idea. Idea one, this is called reduce side join, because the join is happening at the reducer. So again, as I have illustrated earlier, we want to join T and S according to the attribute A. And this means that the join condition is simply an equality check if T.A equals S.A. In the case of natural joins and also equi joins, that's the same thing. And this also works, the algorithm also works in case we do not have only one attribute, but like multiple attributes we want to check for the equality. And we have already answered the idea or the question here, how do we make sure that the tuples that have the same value end up at the same machine? And this is exactly done when we're using the emit call. And this is the key here, right? And here we have to put T.A or respectively S.A in order to guarantee that the tuple that we are sending, let's say T, is coming to the right reducer. So T is sent to the reducer based on T.A. T coming now from S or T relation doesn't really matter. Has to be done for the same, or the has to be done the same way. And then additionally, we also including information where the tuple comes from, if the tuple T is coming from the relation T or the relation S. And this is crucial, as I mentioned, because we do not want to compute a join between S and S or T and T. We want to join only tuple S from S and T from T. And then the reducer takes two tuples where T1 is from T and T2 is from S, and is computing the join. And of course, it has to hold that T1.A is T2.A. And we will see that this is always guaranteed in case of the reduced side join. So here's now the pseudocode for this reduced side join. For the case of an equi-join or natural join, testing for this equality predicate. So here is the tuple x coming into the map. And we're checking now if x is from S, in which case we are emitting with a key x.a a pair of the tuple itself and an indicator that this tuple is coming from relation S. In case x is not from S, so the else case, we are also emitting, according to the key x.a, a pair of x, and now of course we have the indicator that this tuple comes from T. And now on the reduced side, when we have here the key in the reducer, which is one specific value of this attribute A, and then we have here like an array or an iterator over these pairs of tuple, comma, flag, where flag is this indicator if the tuple comes from S or from T. And now what we do, we go over all of these inputs, and according to the flag, if it's S or if it's T, we are adding the tuple to a set S list or a set T list. So that means we have now two sets, S list and T list, containing the attribute or the tuples from S and T that have the same A value, because this is how the reduce works. And now we can go over with a nested loop over all S in S and T in T. And emitting, here we emitting with key null, because it doesn't matter, the concatenation of the tuple S and T. So obviously, because this A value is the same for every reduce call, and so we are guaranteed by the MapReduce framework that all these tuples we're getting here as the values have the same A value. So we do not have to check, and that's important to observe, we do not have to check again if s.a equals t.a, because this is guaranteed by the way MapReduce is grouping these tuples for the same A value in this reduce call. So we do not have to check that here again. However, we have to select from the input tuples here those that are from S and those that are from T, because we do not want to produce joins between the relation S and the relation S again. And the same for T, of course. So the good thing about the reducer join is that it avoids testing pairs of tuples that cannot be joined. Why? Well, a tuple that has a value of 5 from S and a tuple that has a value 6 from T, they will never be inside the same reduce call, because this is how MapReduce works. However, of course, in one reducer node in the system, there will be, of course, multiple tuples with different A values. However, this is like important to remember, the reduce call will only be done separately for these unique A values. The idea behind the reducer join is very similar to the hash join. Also in the hash join, we use some mapping, which was done there by the hash functions, of items, of tuples to buckets. And here we do the same by using the infrastructure provided by MapReduce, this copying around or the shuffling around in the network according to the key used in emit. However, there are some shortcomings. First of all, because we have this join based on these attribute keys, which has to happen because that's the way the join is defined, but this is also the way we are grouping data, it can happen that if you have a poor distribution or a skewed distribution, that this algorithm has a poor load distribution or load balancing property, because some of the reducers will get very many tuples to process. Also, this algorithm has a problem in terms of scalability if this attribute has only very few distinct values. So if you have the attribute here, let's say S, and we have our attribute A, in the worst case, there are only very few, so values, distinct values of A, like this perhaps, right? So there are only two different values for attribute A. That means we can have only at most two partitions for tuples according to this attribute. And this is of course limiting how well this algorithm can scale to very large data sets. The third limitation or problem, this only works for equi-joins or natural joins that are testing for equality. If you have an inequality or so-called band joins, it is not possible to apply this algorithm. Okay, so let's go back to idea two. We call this map-only join or also replicated join. Here the idea is, so you have here our map tasks, which are reading data. And here we assume that they're reading only data from relation S. So there's one block of tuples that we call S1, one block of tuples that we call S2 and S3 and S4. So in this case, we assume that there are only four blocks of S tuples in the system. And now what this join is doing, hence the name replicated join, it would make the relation T available within each of these map processes. So this is of course assumes that T is rather small. So let's see what this means. So we have not only a part of T, but we have the entire T, right? This is important now. So we are joining, we are able to join here the partition S1 with entire T. Here we're joining S2 with T, S3 with T, and S4 with T. This means we can compute here already in this map processes the entire join result. Because if you're looking at the union of the results here, this is exactly S join T. Right? Of course, you can also make the processing of the individual joins here more efficient if you're creating an index on T. So then it's quicker to check if you're looking at one tuple from S, if it has a join partner in T. In case there is no way you can use an index, because the join predicate is not testing for equality, for instance, or some ranges, then you can still use this approach, because this approach can work for all possible join predicates. So this is how the MapReduce implementation of a map-only join looks like in pseudocode. Here we're looking at our mapper, and we also don't need any reducer. This is the only thing that you have to consider in terms of coding. So again, remember that we said that we know the entire relation T in all of the map processes. That means every map process will read a part of S according to the block of S data it is reading, but it knows the entire relation T. So when we're setting up our map process, we're creating for all the tuples T in T using a technique called distributed cache, which basically just provides the relation T. So we are taking these tuples and we're inserting them into, here in this case, an hash index. So this is now the code describing the situation where the join predicate would test also for equality according to attribute A. So we're inserting these T t-tuples into the index according to the a attribute. And now when we are reading a part of s, according to our slice or block of data this process is reading, we are taking this index and we look up the index according to the s.a value. And then we are finding one or more tuples, and we simply output now the concatenation of s and t. In the end, of course, when the process is done, we clean up the used memory. So this means we do not have to have a reducer because the join happens here. And also because we have created the index here, this lookup now avoids testing unnecessary pairs of s and t tuples. However, it is also possible to use this replicated join in case you have arbitrary predicates. So not equality only, but anything you want. We call this zeta joins. This variant of replicated join in case of zeta joins is described here. Here we do not have a hash index, but simply we take a set t where we are reading from this distributed cache all the tuples from t, and this is called t. This is our relation of t tuples. And again, we know t entirely in our map process. And not surprisingly now, what's happening in the map, you're reading your share of s tuples, and this one tuple s you're considering, you go over for this one s out of s I, this is your share of s you're reading here in this map process, you're testing this s tuple against all tuples t out of the relation t that you store in your set t. And you're testing for this predicate zeta if this is fulfilled, and if it's fulfilled, you're emitting the concatenation of s and t. Now this is like basically what we already discussed for the nested loop join, an algorithm that can handle arbitrary join predicates. Because this one is also able to compute the cross product. So if you're removing this check here for zeta, and you're simply emitting s and t, then this is guaranteed to compute the entire cross product. Why? Well, you're computing always the join of the entire t, or the cross product, with this part that the first map part of the task is seeing, and also the cross product with the second, or data the second map task is seeing, and so on. And these are disjoint partitions of s. So in the end, if you're taking the union of the results, this will be the entire cross product. And this is like a big difference to the reducer join, that the map only join, also known as replicated join, can handle arbitrary join predicates. But also it can have the opportunity to use an index, like we have seen on the previous slide, in case you have an equi join predicate. So if you compare now the replicated join with a reducer join, we can see that it got rid of some of the problems the reducer join had. First of all, the replicated join does not care about different distributions or skewed distributions inside these attributes we are joining on. And also it works or doesn't really consider having attributes that have only very few distinct values. And also it works for arbitrary joins, not only limited to equi joins like the reducer join is. And in the reducer join, we were transferring all the tuples from S and T to the reducer. This is not what we're doing, obviously, in the replicated join. However, the replicated join is also not perfect. The replicated join can send in total more data over the network than the reducer join. Also, maybe at first glance it doesn't look like this, but it does, or it can happen. So in the reducer join, we are reading both of the relations, and we are sending the tuples from the relations from the mappers to the reducers. In the replicated join, we are reading one time this T. However, we are sending T to n machines. And then, good thing is we are reading S also only once. However, this one here can mean, depending on the size of T, that this is more wasteful regarding network traffic than the reduced side join. Also, it can happen dataset T is too big to fit in memory, and if it doesn't fit in memory, then we have to also have expensive accesses to hard disk at the map processes. So this indicates already that the replicated join is only really useful if T is much smaller than S, and ideally also fits entirely in main memory. It has, of course, a huge advantage over the reduced side join because it can handle arbitrary theta joins, which was not possible by or to handle by the reduced side join. So in case you have arbitrary theta joins, there's not much options between the two because the reduced side join cannot handle theta joins.